tutorial on confidence intervals, specifically confidence intervals for the mean of a distribution. So the general idea with the confidence interval is that you want to make guesses about the mean, guesses about mu, but you don't know what mu is. In fact, you'll never know what mu is. So what you do is you go out and get a sample and you calculate the sample mean, x bar, and then you use that as your guess for mu. So what I'm saying is that the way you calculate a confidence interval for mu, maybe I should write that down here, for mu, is you start with your best guess. I'm going to call that the point estimate. And it typically has something to do with the sample, the whatever the sample average was. And then from that, you want to add or subtract some number of we'll figure that out based on how confident we want to be, standard deviations. So I write this very generally like this because I think if you remember the formula in these terms, it'll be easy to apply. We got three examples here and they each have a different formula for them. But if you remember it in these terms, you're really only remembering one formula. Just a point. The number of standard deviations, what you're going to add or subtract to your point estimate, is called your margin of error. Okay, so that's all very general. Maybe I'll try to do a more specific example. In this first example here, we have 100 basketball players, and their average vertical, so the sample average was 38 inches. And I somehow know that the standard deviation of all basketball players' verticals, so what I'm getting at there is I know the population standard deviation, sigma, is 10, and I'm asked to create a confidence interval. See, since I want a 95% confidence interval, alpha is equal to 1 minus 0.95, which is 0.05. So using this information, I can create a confidence interval if I refer to this formula up here. First, I want my point estimate, my best guess at what mu would be. That best guess is whatever the average for my sample was, right? I went out and I averaged 100 players. Their average was 38. So that's a good guess for what everybody's average is. But it's probably not right. I don't want to just stick with my guess of 38. I want to create an interval so that I'm more confident that I'm right. So I want to add or subtract some number of, and you denote that as z sub alpha over 2. Standard deviations in this case is sigma divided by the square root of n, because this is the standard deviation for the sampling distribution. So what I get is 38 plus or minus z sub 0.025, maybe I write that over here, 0.025, is saying how many z squares do you have to go out so that you only have 2.5% of the data in the upper tail. That number ends up being 1.96 times sigma is 10, and the square root of 100 is also 10. So what I get is 38 plus or minus 1.96. And it's fine to leave your answer like this. Some people prefer to see it written as an interval. So from 36.04 up to 39.96. I got those numbers just by adding and subtracting this 1.96 from 38. So that gives me the interval. So basically what I'm saying is, all right, my best guess at how high basketball players can jump is 38 inches. That's my best guess for mu. But if I want to be 95% sure of what mu is, I don't want to just guess 38 because that's probably wrong. I want to say it's somewhere between this number 36 and this number 39.9. So this is my confidence interval. And the second one, it's pretty similar to the first one. The main difference is that we don't know sigma. We don't know the population standard deviation. We just know the sample standard deviation. So n changes just because. X bar stayed the same. The sample average is still 38. But now the standard deviation is not sigma. It's s because it's a sample standard deviation. And our alpha, it looks like that changed too. Now that's only 90% instead of 95%. So alpha is 0.10. All right, so I think the biggest thing that's different here is because we know the sample standard deviation and not the population standard deviation. It's a T distribution instead of a Z distribution. So we want T sub half of alpha 0.05 in this case. And to figure that out, you need to know how many degrees of freedom you have. If you have 81 observations in your sample, then you have 81 minus 1, or 80 degrees of freedom. And if you look up the t-score with 5% of the data in the upper table tail with 80 degrees of freedom, what you end up with is 1.664. All right, and using that information, we can figure out our confidence interval. Similar to the first one, our confidence interval, you start with your point estimate, which is x bar, which is 38 again in this example. And then you add or subtract a certain amount of standard deviations. That's your t-score, 1.664. And standard deviations in this case will be s divided by the square root of n. So if you plug that into a calculator, let's see here, we would have 1.664 times 12 divided by 9. That gives you 2.219, something like that, which is fine. You can leave your answer like this, or if you prefer to write it as an interval, we could say it's from, 35.781 all the way up to 40.219. So here's your interval. You can compare that with that one. There's a couple factors making them, let's see, wider and less wide, and they kind of cancel each other out and end up with an interval that's roughly the same size, a little bit wider. And finally, part three, maybe I change colors again. In part three, it's similar, except now it's not x bar we have a proportion. Everything's in proportions here. So the formula looks pretty different. The formula for a confidence interval is given by this mess right here. But what I want to convince you of is that this, in fact, is not that different from what I had in the very top, this guy right here. It's still the same idea. You take a point estimate, you take your best guess, which will be p hat, the proportion of the population. So let's see, in this case, we got 100 basketball players. We got p 62% is our p hat. I think they're above average. And we got alpha is 0.01, because now we want a 99% confidence interval. It turns out with just this information, we can figure out everything we need. So our point estimate, our best guess, is this 0.62 here. And then to make our interval, our margin of error, we want to add or subtract. It's a z-score in this case. It's z sub 0.005. The reason it's a z-score is because you're only estimating one parameter, p, using p hat to estimate it. So even though it feels like you're estimating the mean and the standard deviation, you should use the t, you don't. You're really only estimating one parameter that gives you both of those measures. So our z-score of 0.005 is 2.576. So that is how many standard deviations we want to add or subtract to this 62%. And now we have to figure out what the standard deviation is. The standard deviation, let's see, the standard deviation of p hat, you get using this formula over here. We don't know p, so we'll use p hat. That's our best guess at p. So it's 0.62 times 1 minus 0.62 divided by n, which is 100. And if you plug that into a calculator, 0.62 times 0.38 divided by 100 and take the square root, you get approximately 0.0485. And if you multiply that by 2.576, our critical value, what you get is that our confidence interval is 62% plus or minus 0.1250, call it 0.125. You can leave your answer like that, or you can write it as an interval, 0.495, all the way up to 0.745. So our confidence interval here is between 49.5% and 74.5%. And so that's three different ways to calculate confidence intervals, but really the point I want to get across is they're more similar than they may seem like you have completely different formulas, but really they all kind of follow this general idea. You just have to know whether it's a t-distribution or a z-distribution and how to calculate the relevant standard deviation and point estimate. So I guess that's the end of this tutorial.